Wow, Stephen De La Cruz rocked the house, huh? Stephen's the man. And Dr. Dilda, oh my God, what an awesome morning. So welcome back to Thrive Talks. Our third speaker is Brenda Edelman. Now, I'll tell you something about Brenda, and I've said it a little bit before. She's going to rock your world. If there's anybody you're ever going to listen to, you got to listen to Brenda. So let me tell you how I met Brenda. We were going to the University of Santa Monica. We were studying spiritual psychology. My wife and I were sitting next to each other. Brenda gets up, she raises her hand because she's got something to share. What she shared, like nobody in the room, like everybody was crying, everybody was angry, everybody was blown away, everybody was transformed in that half hour, 45 minutes, an hour. I mean, we got a way of looking at life out of that moment that literally has changed my entire life, how I relate to everybody, how I do everything, how I look at my children, how I look at my wife, how I look at my relationships, everything. It changed everything. So hang tight because this could change everything for you. So her story is called The Impact of Your Story. So please give me a lot of love, a lot of heart, share this, invite all your friends, and let me introduce the amazing, the beautiful, the gorgeous, the incredibly talented Brenda Edelman.
Thank you.
Hi, Eddie. How are you?
What an awesome introduction. Thank you so much.
You give me a lot of good material.
Thank you. I had no idea that was the impact it had for you and your wife all those years ago. That's amazing. And that's why I keep sharing.
Awesome. You know, I still talk to people that we went to school with, and we always talk about you.
Wow.
Like, we're always talking about, remember Brenda?
Wow, yeah. I am so blessed. Thank you. I'm so glad I've been able to turn things around so that I can share in a way that impacts people.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I'm going to let you do your thing. Brenda Edelman.
Thank you. I'll just tell you, I'm going to do a little treat today. I've never done this before. I have a 60-minute one-woman show based on my life story, but I decided to do about 12, 15 minutes of it live for you here today so that you can look at it and look at the impact that telling your story will make. In a bygone era, before big box chain stores took over, a savvy businessman, my father, was able to build an empire in automobile parts. He was an alpha male Guido, kind of like Joe Pesci from the film My Cousin Vinny, little Tony Soprano thrown in, only Jewish. In a world filled with mind numbing pedestrian aspirations, my mother dared to be her bohemian artist self. She was a sultry blend of the movie star Anne Margaret with some fierce and wacky Lady Gaga thrown in. She took me traveling with her all over the world and read Shakespeare to me from the time I was 3 years old as a bedtime story. I admire Shakespeare. There are so many layers to everything he's ever written. Tonight, my favorite, Brenda. To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the good night, sweet princess. I love you. To incy, incy, teensy, weensy little pieces. Remember this above all else, to thine own self be true. My husband, Jerry, has these arms. I feel safe when I'm inside them. He looks like Marlon Brando, tough, tough guy, but he's got a tender side too. I've seen it at least twice. He knows how to provide for us, but he works all the time. So on the weekends, I escape into Manhattan with the kids in the back seat of Jerry's fire engine, red Cadillac. I sink into the butter-soft, white leather seats and speed down the West Side Highway in what I lovingly refer to as my pimpmobile. We go to museums, galleries, and Broadway shows, like my favorite, Carol Channing singing, "And Diamond's Abigail's Best Friend." Gotta love her. Once, after seeing Frank Langella as Dracula on Broadway, the sexiest Dracula alive, I was inspired. When I got home, I slipped into a pair of red high-heeled stilettos, dressed my son, my daughter, and myself up as bats to welcome Jerry home from work to Transylvania. That turned him on. But what didn't? He left me broke and for another woman about every 7 years. That Bobby is a green-eyed beauty. Beautiful! The first time I saw her, she comes into my auto body parts store and her body parts, boom, boom, knocked me out. A good talk. Edelman is an institution on the corner of Coney Island Avenue and Avenue L, opened by my parents in 1938. Started working there when I was 13 and built it from that small corner store to the hot heaven that it is today. Added a 10,000 square foot warehouse, tire and lube shop, and an eight lift service garage. So Bobby comes in, she got a body that can stop a truck. And she needed me. Ha! My single days were numbered. One time, for Halloween, that green-eyed monster comes down the stairs to go to a party wearing a see-through raincoat with a skin-colored bodysuit on underneath, on which she had painted on, in details, the family jewels, Meshuggah, my wife's crazy. She's what they call artistic, always creating things out of thin air, paintings, photographs, puppets for her son. When she comes into the store on the weekends to pick up the Cadillac and I see my little girl Brenda, my whole face lights up. She's my Brenda Bethenda, my great defender. With two peas in a pot, same dazzling blue eyes, straight nose, long fingers. She's a little me without the Cuban cigar. The problem with Bobby these days is all she wants to do is click, click with her camera, spend my money, and go away. I bust my ass so she could have anything she wants. I work 15 hours a day, 7 days a week, 363 days a year. I only close the store for the high holy days. Not a religious man, but out of respect for the neighbors, you gotta do the right thing. I like the simple things in life, a good dinner, a long drive, a little taking Bobby out to Long Island, to Montauk Point, to the lighthouse, looking out over the water. Beautiful. Beautiful. My parents were total opposites. It was like growing up in the same household with a gorilla and a peacock, and I'm a pretty good mix of the two. The first time I went shooting, I was 10. My dad picked me up from sleepaway camp in the Poconos, where I learned my first Jewish prayer. And on the way back to Brooklyn, we made a pit stop to my first shooting range. Come here, Bethenda. Let me see you be a big girl. I want you to take this gun, put it in the palm of your hand, point to the target, over there, well, over there, and shoot. Okay, Daddy, boom! The recoil nearly blasted my shoulder out of its socket, and it hurt. But I never told my dad because he was so proud of me for shooting his gun. 20 years later, I escaped Brooklyn and the role I played right between my parents. I fell in love and moved to California. I remember signing up for this all-day business of acting workshop. I got home exhausted but excited at 8 p.m. Honey, oh my God, I am so sorry I didn't call all day. We were networking on the breaks. I met so many wonderful, talented people. We're going to start a writing group. I'm sorry I didn't call all day. It was so great. The place is so clean. Maybe I should spend the day away more often. Let me go put my stuff down and we'll eat. I bet you're really hungry. My fiance greeted me. Brenda, sweet Brenda, I'm glad your day was so beautiful. I wish every day could be as beautiful. There's been an accident. Your father, a gun. Your mother's dead. I flew to New York the next day. I went directly to see the police, who were waiting. Thank you for coming, Miss Edelman. We know it's been a long day. Your father won't talk to us. Seems he had a lawyer with him before we even got to your house and discovered your mother. And this looks bad for him, and we know he's a good guy. Who doesn't know Jerry Edelman from Edelman's Auto? The cops get home from the neighborhood. By the way, your mother was shot, and we have reason to believe it wasn't a suicide. We left the precinct, and I went to see my father. Dad, what happened? Your mother and I, we were fighting for days. You know how she is. Finally, I don't want to listen no more, so I went upstairs to go to sleep. The next thing I know, she's on top of me with the gun. It went off. I don't know who pulled the trigger. Where did she get the gun? I don't know. She must have come upstairs with it loaded. The police said you didn't call them for 8 hours. Where were you? I don't know. I don't remember anything after that. Point blank range in the head, and you claim it was an accident? I wish that I could shoot you in your head so I could believe that you really don't remember. I hate you! Is what I wanted to say, but I couldn't. Because I loved him, too, with all my heart. Within a month, while awaiting trial, my father moved in with my aunt Janet. They had been friends for the 30 years that my parents were married. It gave me comfort knowing that my mother's older sister believed in my father's innocence. I remembered how distraught he was the day of the funeral. He wanted me to move back to New York to take care of him, and I loved him, but he took my mother from me. Flying to New York once a month to meet with lawyers, to go through the home I grew up in and collect my mother's artwork and bring it to California, I would stay with my new makeshift family, watching as my aunt wore my mother's clothing and my father told my cousin that she was beautiful. They were two peas in a pod. I watched myself become invisible as my father rewrote my life with a new cast. But I clung to my old identity. I mean, who was I if I wasn't my father's daughter? So when I returned to California, I spoke with him every day. Our conversations lasted less than 5 minutes. On my next trip back 2 months later, he picked me up from the airport. We went directly to Long Island to my aunt's house, went down to the basement where he had set up his office, and he invited me to his upcoming wedding. What? What? Mom's not even dead for 6 months. Thought you'd be happy for me. Happy for you? Who is it? Oh, what do you know? I followed my gut upstairs to where I saw her. My aunt. Oh, God. A beast that wants discourse of reason would have mourned longer. Married with my aunt? My mother's sister? But no more like my mother than I to Hercules. Within a month, I closed my heart to my father right there and returned to California. The problem? With no direct contact, he lived even more vividly in my mind. My father went to jail on a plea bargain, involuntary manslaughter. You see, the murder weapon, the gun used to kill my mother, the one I learned to shoot on, was never found. He never told us what happened, but the plea bargain said that he caused our mother's death by recklessly causing his pistol to discharge directly into her head. He got out of his 1.5 to 5 year sentence in 2 years for good behavior. When he got out, he called me from my Aunt Janet, my mother's sister, my stepmother's house. Ooh, it was rough in there on vacation. Nobody should have to go through that. Dad, it's good to hear your voice. I missed you. I miss you too. How come you never came to see me? You're always my friend of Agenda. Dad, I told you I need to know what happened the night Mom died. Told you the past is the past. Can't talk about those things. It's not going to bring her back. How's your love life? Glenn and I broke up. Eh, never really liked Glenn anyway. I bet you look beautiful. Bet you got hundreds of guys chasing you down. You got to come over here to the East Coast. You got family that loves you. on the way there, my lawyer is going to call your lawyer to ask for one third of the money that your mother had. I love her, but by New York law, one third of that money is mine. Who do you think made all money anyway? Looking out my 16th floor window, I fantasized about escaping from the tyranny of my mind and my memories, stepping out into the abyss and joining my mother. To be or not to be, that is the question. Mom, are you here? Can you hear me? Can I forgive Daddy, or should I hold on to this rage for eternity? Whether 'tis noble in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against the sea of troubles and my opposing enemy. What will happen to my soul if I take my own life? I don't think I'll be with you again, Mom. In Shakespeare's great tragedy, this is where Hamlet, in his righteous rage, fought till the ending and died. But I don't want to end it that way. I must release this rage, robbing me like a thief through depression and apathy. I can't get close to anyone. Wasn't I damaged goods because of my family? How could I ever trust again? I trusted my father, and look what happened. I poured my pain out of my head and heart into the pages of my journal during my sleepless nights, and I wrote 100 poems in 30 days. I wrote my story. I went back to school to get a master's in spiritual psychology, and something happened. Something cracked open. I felt something bigger than me, something good, God, moving through all of this, even my story. And from this place of openness, I realized that nothing my father could have told me would bring my mother back. And she is in my heart. She is in my soul. She lives on through me. I'm not alone. Methinks I see my mother in my mind's eye. I recalled a memory from when I was 5. Good night, sweet princess. I love you to eensy, weensy, teensy, weensy little pieces. Remember this above all else. To thine own self be true. I surrender to the wisdom my mother passed on to me through my love of Shakespeare, and I got Shakespeare's words, which became my truth. There is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so. Something I thought broke me was no longer bad because it truly broke me open. I knew what I needed to do. I had to release my judgments against my parents so I was no longer bonded to them. Mom, I forgive myself for judging you as a victim too caught up in your story to be there for me. As I judge you, I become a victim to my own story. I know who you truly are. Good night, sweet princess. May flights of angels sing thee to thy rest. I was guided to do a ceremony of release with my father. I took his hat, and I felt angels by my side as I walked to the top of a mountain. Dad, I forgive myself for judging you as cold-hearted and abandoning me. If I judge any part of you, I judge a part of myself, and I am no longer willing to do that. Right here, right now, I open my heart again and embrace that beautiful part of you, the essence of who you are that lives in me as me every day. I threw his hat over the mountainside, watching as it disappeared from my sight, and with my next breath, a heaviness lifted off of me, and I realized I was no longer my father's great defender or my mother's protector. I was no longer like Hamlet in his tragic, in his righteous unforgiveness and tragic demise. I was just me, Brenda. Yes, Brenda, the red hot contender, a contender for love and life. Mom, Dad, I love you. I forgive you. And I set myself free.
That was amazing.
Oh, thank you.
So I was just telling Stephen, out there, he's like, is this real?
Yeah, my story.
It's a real story. This is a real story.
It's my story. I don't even know if I said that before.
Well, I remember when the first time you said it in public. You know, that was amazing.
Right,
that
because I was so terrified to tell my story. It was before I did the show, and I was like thinking I was going to get so much judgment, and instead I got just an outpouring of love and people sharing with me their stories.
And we learned, I was trying to remember, what is the thing that we learned that day? Because we had, that was second year, right? That was second year.
I think it was first year.
Okay. Wow. So USM, Spiritual Psychology, 2 years, master's course, and so we were doing that together, and what they teach you is judgment. It's like forgive myself for judging. So it's kind of like, for me, one of my things has been my weight. So it's like I would judge myself, you're fat. And so if I judge myself as fat, I go, well, I forgive myself for judging. It's not that I don't do that. It's
because what you have power over is what's in our mind and what's in our thoughts once we get conscious of it.
Exactly. So. And then you had said, you forgave yourself for judging yourself. That's what it was.
Yeah.
And it was like, whoa, that's what it means, For me, it was a little thing.
There was so much self-forgiveness. I mean, that's what it really, so much of it came down to, was forgiving myself for trusting my father. That was a big one. And of course I would trust my father.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. So, what I wanted to say is that I am so passionate about teaching people how to forgive their past. Like, look at their stories, and so that it's almost like look at your story really deeply so you can extract yourself from it and then tell your story in a way that changes people's lives. And that's what I'm focused on, and I'm also focused on how do you do it creatively so that you knock people out so that God knows how many, over a decade, people are still thinking about it and you don't even know the effects that you've had on people, because I didn't know a lot of that.
I got stories. I got things that happened to me, friends killed, fights, all kinds of crazy stuff that's happened to me. And some of it, for me, just to talk about it, it's hard for me because I get choked up.
Exactly.
There's a story about my wife and me when I discovered something about the way I was acting. I tell people the story, but I'm almost over emotional telling
the
story.
Right, and that's a big thing that I teach people, because everything that you're talking about, I've gone through. Too emotional, because what happens is oftentimes we don't speak our story, and then when we realize we can, it's like oversharing, and then you end up draining people. You end up retreating because you think, oh shit, I told too much.
What am I saying? Yeah.
So I teach on that, like how do you craft your story, tell it, and then work on it emotionally at the same time so that you're sharing the perfect amount, so that you're sharing something really emotional, because we don't want to take the emotions out, but it's like the emotions are serving you instead of them running the show, and then knowing and then being joyous after. Because when I first started sharing this, I'd feel like shit afterwards, even though people were helped.
Just emotionally draining you?
Right.
Okay.
And instead, now I've learned how to feel amazing because I'm letting the line of spirit move through me, and to connect with other people, not be over responsible for them. But your stories are important, because if you don't tell them, there are people out there that are isolated and don't realize that they're alone. And then once you're able to tell them, because you've worked through your emotions,
I wrote a book. It's my book, and I wrote my book, and my book has some nice little stories in it. But the stories with all the guts, the stories with all the emotions,
the
stories
with
like,
you gotta go there.
I gotta go to your class.
You do. I'm doing one in-person class actually soon, but in August. But that's a one-person show class. But yes, well, and my virtual class.
As a speaker, so I need to probably
my virtual class. Is Your Story Made Simple, which is there's 2 weeks specifically on the healing part of our stories, and I think that's where I differ from what other teachers are teaching.
Yeah.
I've been there. I can hold a space for just about anything. I teach people how to, like, even in a group when they're learning, how do you share appropriately so you're not pulling on people, getting yourself more drained? So it's really important, because those kind of stories are the ones that change the world.
Yeah, and I think the other thing is too, as we learned at USM, is that we go to, like, when I went to USM, I wanted a master's in spiritual psychology because I wanted to go out and teach people and help people, and who I helped was myself. And that's kind of like, that's what happens. Is that what happens with your,
To tell you the truth, yes. Well, writing your story is incredibly healing. What I love about the one person show format is that, which is different than writing a book, is that you have to inhabit the character. So I'm inhabiting my dad.
Yeah.
As my dad, I can't play him a villain because people don't play ourselves as a villain.
Sure.
So it was incredibly, extraordinarily healing for me to look at him as him. And then I could play
his greatness as in his expression.
As a man with dreams that were thwarted. Yeah. As a man who didn't, you know, maybe had mental illness. As a man who, you know, didn't know what to do. Not ever condoning.
Sure.
I talk a lot about forgiveness, but it's never forgetting and it's never condoning. It's but the forgiveness that I teach and the way I teach it is like finding a compassionate way in so that what I learned is if I have my heart shut to him, it's shut to me.
Yeah. That's what Yvette, that's what my wife Yvette has always said about you is it, and she uses an example, she uses your example, like it's been how many years? It's been a long time, like almost 20 years. So,
wow.
So she uses your example, 17 years, not that long. That's right, 15 years, 10 years. But she uses your example when she talks to other people, and I use the same example. You can, so when you think about Brenda's story, you can forgive, but you don't have to go and hang out with the person.
Right, and right? I didn't say it in this. Because it was just 15 minutes, but I took my dad's court for wrongful death. For wrongful death, so I set a very strong boundary.
I remember that. I think you did.
Right, I think it was
in
the second
year. Yeah.
And it gave me the, what happened was I looked into forgiveness, and then when I looked into forgiveness, I'm like, well, I don't want him in my life. This man's never taken responsibility. There's no remorse, but I want to forgive him so I don't feel that contraction.
Yeah.
And then I made a powerful self-honoring decision to take him to court.
Good for you. It's an amazing story, I tell you. What do you think, Linda?
Yeah, absolutely. First time I've done it on video.
Really?
Yeah,
wow.
I'm really excited
That's
about that.
Super cool.
So yeah, and then I, you know, I do teach this. I have a free opt-in that.
Okay, so can we? Do you have the opt-in? We put that up on the.
Yeah, so it's
cool.
It's tell your story, heal yourself, create more wealth, and it's just like the seven different ways that I've told my story to heal myself first. USM, I wanted to heal. You know, who? It was the opposite for me. I didn't go to study spiritual psychology to teach. I went to heal myself at a deep level, and then I started teaching.
So, like, well, you're sharper than that. You knew that.
No, I don't know about that. I do actually try to go within and be like, well, what's next? What's my soul calling me to do?
That's another place to go to. University of Santa Monica, spiritual psychology, and the most amazing course on the planet, truly.
Amazing.
And I've done it
changed
all.
My life. I kind of feel like my life, I used to say my life was, you know, what happened before my mom was murdered and after. And then when I went to USM, it was like my life before USM and after because of the radical responsibility I learned about and also how to stop asking why and start being like, well, how can I thrive? Now that this happened, how can I learn? How can I thrive? How can I grow versus how do I just get by?
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, Brenda Avalon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For having me.